just as I stepped on the deck, a bomb hit the water outside the ship, and a concussion blew me back through the curtains and to my buddy, which was following me. The results were near misses, and the water to each side of the ship. This caused slight damage, but no casualties. On reporting this on the radio, Tokyo Rose claimed the ship with B-29 crews aboard was sunk. This was one of the many times my guardian was on my shoulder and my God took care of me. By ship and train, we arrived in Chikuya, India, where I served as Armored Crew Chief on B-29 aircraft.
And you were a corporal at that time?
I was a corporal at that time. I was responsible for two airships. It was my duty to see that the guns and bomb racks were properly maintained. I also supervised loading the ammunition and bomb load for each mission. The only accident encountered by my crew and me when we were loading a 2,000-pound bomb, it was being hoisted up to me, but a deteriorating deteriorating harness broke loose and the bomb fell down and mashed the track back apart. There were no injuries at all, though.
That's not when the machine gun went off and blew off that guy's hand.
That was
you don't tell us about that
later. I don't know if it's in yet. I don't know if it is or not. I can't remember.
We observed each mission takeoff.
Another incident of my guardian angel and my Lord being with me. When we observed each mission takeoff and were present at our ship's return from the mission, I took pride in the fact that every ship that my crew and I ready for each mission was safely returned with no casualties and only minor flat damage. On January 4, 1945, one of the most costly tragedies in the history of the 4th Bomb Group occurred in Chikuya, when fragmentation bombs were being unloaded from an aircraft. One of the cluster binders broke and several bombs fell to the ground, exploded on contact. The explosion caused a fire in the aircraft, which ignited and caused other frag bombs to explode, completely destroying that aircraft and damaging other aircraft parked nearby. We were not in that.
There were 8 fatalities at that time.
Yeah, that's right, read that. I can't see.
There were 8 fatalities and many serious injuries among the personnel in that area.
We were not in that immediate area, but were near enough for fragments of exploding bombs to pass over our shoulders. We unloaded the fragmentation bombs from our 2 aircraft using extreme caution. I personally examined each binder on every cluster. I determined that they were safe to be unloaded, to be lowered. Due to the terrific heat with the erratic area temperature of 100 degrees between 10 o'clock in the morning and mid-afternoon, we become accustomed to being hard hours without sleep and reporting for duty at various times. In June of 1944, the first direct hit was made on Japan when B-29 took off
June 13th and 14th.
But pronounce it Hinsing?
Hinsing, China.
China. See, we had a forward base there. That was our advanced base. And these planes took off from there to bomb Japan.
All phases of the 40th bomb group at Chukalia.
At Chukalia.
At Chukalia were involved in this.
Yeah. Our armament.
Crews.
Crews had prepared tanks of fuel and other supplies, which had to be transported to the advanced base. Important military officers and numerous
war correspondents
were present to witness and to lend emphasis to the fact that the mission would be one of the great events of World War II. Earlier on the morning of June 16th, the B-29s took off from the
Chinese
base. I can't see it.
Well, it was a particular target, which was an iron and steel works at Jawata, Japan.
That's right. Ship I worked on, but one had come back and shot it pretty bad. And when it landed, it broke in two. But it didn't kill anybody, didn't hurt anybody.
Outside of that, you only lost the one that crashed on takeoff. Not on the shot down over Japan.
None of the ships that was in my group, in my squadron. See, I was in 25th, but we didn't lose a ship.
There you go.
When did I get it?
August 15th, 1945.
President Truman announced the war was over. VJ, August 19th, 1945, the official sign of the surrender term took place on the battleship Missouri in the Japanese harbor. As I had earned special points, I was given a choice of flying home or coming by ship. First aircraft that took off, the 40th Bomb Group departed from 10 on October 6, 1945, by Kwajalein and Hawaii. We landed at Mesa Field, California on October 1st, 1945. As soon as the plane parked and the bomb doors opened, I opened it. When I opened it, I swung out of the plane, got on my knees and thanked my Lord and my guardian angel for my safe return to good old USA. I boarded a troop train and was honorably discharged October 25th, 1945 at Rockdale Field, Louisiana.
You were staff?
Thus ended my, huh?
You were staff sergeant?
I was staff sergeant at that time. Thus ended my World War II experience, trip around the world. That's it.
That's good.
I saw a nice little bit talking.
You don't want to put in there about the guy giving you a liquor?
Well, I guess if you... Should I?
Yeah, go ahead. Okay. It's a funny story, Lord. I mean, and that's what we're trying to do. You guys have a lot of things like that out.
Well, we were loading out for a mission. Now, as I told you before, I had two ships to load and get ready for the mission. And we were diligent doing our job. I had a good crew. And these two officers came up there. One was first lieutenant, brand new one from Atlanta, Georgia, just got out of school. And the other was a warrant officer from Texas. And they wanted to send us some help. I said, well, no, I don't need any help. My crew and I will be ready. No, I don't think you'll be ready, but I said, I'll be ready. My crew knows what to do. They all got a certain job. And you put somebody else in there, you're going to mess the whole thing up. They said, we're going to send him up here. I said, I don't want him. If you send him, you are responsible for anything that happens. And I can tell you exactly what I said, but you know good and well that he ain't going to mess up. That's all he's ever done. He said, well, we're going to send him anyway. I said, well, send him on up here. Then. I don't want him. But you're going to be responsible for anything that happens. So he put the shackle on the bomb. Reversed it. The arms of the release mechanism set in a little slot about like that. And when they turned the switch on, it came together and tripped the bomb, and the bomb went out. Well, this one was put on that wrong end and didn't fit in no slots like it was supposed to. But I was up there loading the bomb, but all I would do was put the shackle in the correct hangar. They went on the mission. When they came back, that bottom bomb was still on it, right. They came down and looked at it, said, now, well, we're going to have to court-martial you. I said, is that right? Yes, sir. You messed up. And I told you it was your responsibility, not mine. He said, well, you didn't want to put your bomb up there, so you had to be court-martial. I reached in my pocket, put out a black book. And on such and such a date, y'all gave me a fifth of liquor. Because I told you I'd take it to the pistol to give it that alcoholic you put on my crew. And I don't fool any liquor over here. But it's a stand order. She will not furnish an enlisted man with liquor. he's finally able to fill. Also, the standing order that you would not borrow or lend money to an innocent man. You borrowed some money from me and you paid me some interest on it. And so if I'm caught by it, I know too soon, the missing don't go by it.
That ended that.
Never heard more about it.
Love it, that's fantastic. Have you got any other stories you'd like to tell us?
Well, we had a young man in our outfit when we got overseas. He lost his mind, so to speak. He wouldn't take a bath. And honestly, I don't know what all he did on himself, but he did a lot. We kept trying to get him to get a shower and he refused. So one day we got some GI brushes, some GI soap, and we got a hold of him and carried him to the shower. We stripped him off, we wet him down and we scrubbed him, got out of there with that GI brush and that soap, rinsed him off, and he went on back to the barracks. But they left him, he reported him, so they took him out. Didn't they send back to the States? They didn't do anything in the world with us.
No.
That's about it.
But we want to appreciate your sharing this with us and appreciate also what you did for your country back many years ago. And appreciate you coming over this afternoon.
Wait, you
got one?
I want to tell you another story. When we were in India, we organized an NCO club, and we had a certain day to open up, celebrate it. So after we opened up, we were getting ready to open up, I went down, and the boys had some lime juice and lemon, a lime drink and a lemon drink. Then we opened it, but they also had some liquor. They asked me if I'd like a drink, a mixed drink. I said, no, sir. No, I'm a gentleman. So we just take her, and the boys knew me. They were talking to me. They said, well, were you like a lemonade or a limeade, whatever it was? I said, sure, I'd like one of that. They gave me one. And I think they must have put some vodka in it because I couldn't taste any liquor. And I drank that in a big glass about that high. I drank that. About the time I got down to the end of it, I said, what the hell y'all give me? They started laughing. And I felt like I was getting drunk, so I left. And I went back to the barracks calling the hogs.
Well, you also said that you got sick drinking the water over there, and you drank beer the rest of you.
The first day we were able to get out. Been there long to get out and do some cleanup around our. We were in tents then. And it was just jungle down below us. So I was working, I got real thirsty. And then brought us some water in a duffel bag, or a water bag anyway. I drank a canteen of a cup of water. And I went back to work. And then a little bit of everything in me went out. I had no control whatsoever. But that I did not drink any more water as long as I was in India. I didn't like beer, but I drank beer.
You drank the beer?
I drank the beer. I swapped my group. We got fruit juices. We allotted so many cans of fruit juice and so many cans of beer. But I swapped my juices for the beer. I spread this can of the fruit juice anyway. But I drank beer the whole time I was over. I drank, come out of July about after 10 o'clock and stayed out about 4 because it was too hot. You couldn't get on those airplanes.
Yeah.
You know, I think those GI shoes would burn your feet through them.
Well, Kenneth, have you kept up with any of the guys that went over there with you? Y'all ever get together on reunions?
No, I don't ever. Well, I tell you this, when I landed in California, made the field. kiss the ground and thank my Lord, my angel, Satan, God, and angel that I was back home. And I promised him, them, and myself that I'd never get on another airplane unless they put me on one to come to Georgia. They put me on one to come to Georgia, so I ain't been on one.
You haven't been on an airplane since then?
I had too many close calls.
Yeah, you, how about the guy that blew his fingers off?
Oh, well, the upper turret gun went up, hung up. And he was hitting me. I told him to go up and I had to ask that. I had them tube used. I put the tube in there and pulled it. Got an operation of a gun, but you pull the block back and hold on to it. What he did, and I told him not to open that. I said, you don't got to open that gun, don't you? The top. He went up and opened the top, and when he did, that thing went forward. Blew his hand, but half his hand off. So he came home. He said, come home.
Kenneth was. Thank you again for being with us and sharing all these experiences and adventures, and also what you did for your country. Thank you.